You now know all basic operations with complex numbers: addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and integer power. You may wonder whether you can do all the other operations you know, like exponentials, logarithms, sine and cosines, etc., with complex numbers too. The answer is yes, we can. We'll start out with a complex exponential, and we take this complex exponential first for two reasons. First of all, it's by far the easiest function, and secondly, because many other functions are based on the complex exponential. So how can we compute e to the power z? Let us take a look. Suppose we have some complex number z equals a plus b times I, and we want to compute the complex exponential e to the power z becomes e to the power a plus b times I, and we define it as e to the power a times e to the power b times I. So we want that our normal rules from real analysis still hold, so we define this as that you can split it up in e to the power a times e to the power b times I, just as you could do with real numbers. So e to the power a is now fine, because a is a real number. But what about our e to the power b times I? For that, we have Euler's formula. We define it as follows. E to the power b times I equals cosine b plus I times sine b. Why do we do this like that? Well, if you have already seen Taylor's series, you can understand why it is like that. You can use the Taylor's series of the exponential function, of the cosine, of the sine, and you can understand why it is like that. If you haven't seen Taylor's series yet, well, you will have to be a bit more patient until you have learned Taylor's series later on in your curriculum. So, now we know how to compute e to the power z. Let's do some examples. So, if z equals minus 2 plus 3 times I, how do we compute e to the power minus 2 plus 3 times I? We split it into two parts, e to the power minus 2 times e to the power of 3i. E to the power minus 2 is just some real number, so that is fine. And for e to the power of 3i, we use Euler's formula that equals cosine 3 plus I times the sine of 3. So, there we are. So, that's how you can compute the exponential of some complex number z. And it has a consequence. Remember how we used the polar form of a complex number z? We wrote z equals r times the cosine of theta plus I times r times the sine of theta. We can take out the r, and then we get r times cosine theta plus I times sine theta. And now we see something nice happen over here. This cosine theta plus I times sine theta is exactly of this form, cosine something plus I times sine something. So this is exactly r times e to the power I theta. And this, so we can write the polar form of a complex number as a complex exponential. And this way of writing it as a complex exponential has some advantages if you want to memorize formulas. For example, if we have two complex numbers written in polar form, now we use this exponential notation, so we write them as z1 equals r1 times e to the power I theta 1, and z2 equals r2 times e to the power I theta 2. If we then take the product, you immediately see that you have to take r1 times r2 times e to the power I theta 1 times e to the power I theta 2, and you can just use your normal rules for real exponentials, so you can add them up as e to the power I theta 1 plus theta 2. So now we can see straight away this formula which we saw when we were doing the Mavre theorem. In that case, we had to do this manipulation with sine and cosines. And here it's much easier, you can just see it straight away. So the Mavre's formula also becomes a lot easier. If you write again your z as r times cosine theta plus I times sine theta, becomes r times e to the power I theta. If you take the nth power of that, z to the power n, you know from the Mavre what you had to do, r to the power n cosine n theta plus I times sine theta n theta. That was the Mavre's formula. So if you write this formula over here and polar form, you just keep the r to the power n, and you see that you have e to the power I n theta. That's the Mavre's formula. But you see, if you know how to manipulate exponentials, you can get it straight away. Because if you take z to the power n, you should take this one to the power n, which yields the r to the power n, e to the power I and theta. So using the complex exponential, you can write down the Mavis formula immediately. It's much easier to memorize. And then finally, let us apply this to this funny number, I to the power I. What happens if you compute I to the power I? Well, the trick is to write the first I, so the I below, as a complex exponential. For that, you need its norm and its argument. Well, the norm of I is just equal to 1, and the principal value of the argument equals pi over 2. So you can write any the lower I as 1, the norm, e to the power I, pi over 2 plus k times 2 pi, where k is in z. And what happens if you take this one to the power I? Well, then you work out the I as you would do. So you have something of the form e to the power number times number. It becomes e to the power the product of those numbers. So you multiply I with this number over here, and you get e to the power minus pi over 2 minus k times 2 pi. So this funny looking I to the power I, first of all, it becomes a real number. And first of all, you get infinitely many real numbers. Well, that's odd. That's because we're dealing with complex numbers. Well, I'll see this property more often. You can how to compute complex exponentials, and you see you can use them for all kinds of problems.